The highly pathogenic avian influenza outbreak has become the largest animal health emergency in U.S. history. Mass mortality composting was implemented on the majority of infected poultry operations during the recent avian influenza outbreaks. Composting is the controlled biological decomposition process that converts organic matter into a stable, humus-like product and generates temperatures adequate to destroy most pathogens, including the avian influenza virus. Essentially, large windrows are formed by surrounding poultry carcasses and manure with carbon materials such as wood chips, wood shavings, corn stover, or other available carbon materials. One of the first steps in implementing the method is to assess the amount of carbon available on the farm, including the litter in the poultry houses, stored litter, and clean shavings.
Effective composting requires an appropriate carbon to nitrogen ratio. We know the amount of nitrogen that we have in the form of poultry carcasses. Generally speaking, it takes a pound for every pound of carcasses that we have, it takes a pound and a half of carbon. So to start with, after we calculate our weight in poultry carcasses, we determine the amount of carbon that we have in the form of litter that's either in storage or within the poultry house itself and other materials that we might have, such as shavings that are stored on site. Once we determine the amount of carcasses that we have on the farm and the amount of carbon that we have in the form of litter and other commodities, it's very simple math to determine how much additional carbon we're going to need to bring from offsite.
Often this assessment concludes that additional carbon material is needed from offsite sources. The selection of appropriate carbon material is critical to the success of the operation. Factors that impact the suitability of a carbon source include particle size and structure, moisture content, absorptive capacity, and the presence of contaminants.
Ideally, a carbon source would have obviously some available carbon. It would have a mix of textures where hopefully the largest piece was no more than 1.5 to 2 inches and wouldn't all be fine materials. So it has to be a mix of different textures. You would want something that's relatively fresh rather than old material, and something that has a moisture content that, you know, theoretically is between 50 and 65% moisture, and it has energy. The ability for that material to generate heat on its own would be ideal.
The bacteria and other organisms responsible for generating the heat that inactivates the avian influenza virus require an adequate supply of oxygen. When compost windrows are appropriately designed, oxygen naturally flows in through the pore spaces in the base of the windrow and out through the top. Particle size is a key factor in determining a material's ability to transfer oxygen. Carbon materials should be porous and bulky enough to allow adequate airflow. Very fine particles, like wood dust and other wood byproducts, have very little pore space and do not transfer oxygen well. However, materials with particle sizes greater than 2 inches do not break down during the composting process and will likely generate a product that is unacceptable as a soil amendment. Materials like straw that do not maintain their structure under the weight of the windrow can limit the flow of oxygen. Moisture content is also an important consideration. Typically, composting subject matter experts select a carbon material that is dry enough to absorb the fluids released from the birds during the decomposition process.
Well, moisture is important because obviously your biological activity requires enough moisture. So I like to do a squeeze test on the materials to make sure it feels damp to the touch and will kind of ball up. That usually tells you the moisture is going to be ideal for the biological activity.
There may be situations, such as in a very dry environment, or when the birds have already partially decomposed, where a carbon material with more moisture will enhance the composting process. Carbon materials have varying absorptive capacity. Some materials, like kiln-dried shavings, absorb liquids quickly. Materials with waxy coatings, like many seed hulls and plant stocks, require time to absorb decomposition fluids.
When you're sourcing carbon, in addition to the actual characteristics of the material, you really need to look for the contaminants that might be in that material as well. One of the things we often get are some plastics or glass material, especially if there's some yard waste material involved. But we also get sometimes big logs that come into that material. The other thing that's important is when you're sourcing, you need to look for what kind of material was used to create that carbon. One of the things that we really have to avoid are contaminants that might come in that you can't use when you land apply it at the end. So that might be pressure treated materials or painted materials or large rocks or chunks of concrete.
Composting during an animal disease outbreak often requires using a variety of carbon materials. By understanding the factors described, a composting subject matter expert can utilize the available carbon materials in the most effective manner. Waxy coated materials like seed hulls may not be as effective for a base, but they may be acceptable as part of the windrow core. Very fine materials may not be appropriate as a base, but they may make an effective cap. By understanding the purpose of each element of the windrow and the characteristics of the available carbon resources, windrows can be constructed that support heat, generating biological activity, while minimizing leachate production and vector attractiveness.